Today, as I could barely talk, I talked to Pastor Dennis, and he decided he'd come and help me out. So wonderful. So we're blessed to have Pastor Dennis and Bevy Joe with us. So we're going to get to hear a wonderful word from the Lord here in a little bit. But let's open up with a word of prayer and thanksgiving to the Lord for all that he's done for us. Would you stand with me if you can? And we're just going to give God some praise this morning. Heavenly Father, we're just so grateful for all that you do for us, Lord. God, we're so grateful that we get to stand in the assembly of believers this morning and lift our voices to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Father, we ask God for, with grateful hearts, that you would meet us here in a special way. Father God, you know the needs of every person within the sound of my voice, Lord God. And I ask, Father, that you would meet us each where we are today. God, that you would transform us, change us, and make us more like your Son. Father, we're so grateful for all that you do. And we ask in the precious and mighty name of Jesus that you would lead this service today. Have your way. In Jesus' name, amen. You can be seated. I'm just going to go through a couple of quick announcements. I still have a little tickle, so I am choking that back a little bit. But here we have. So you may have noticed in the lobby, I believe it's an orange box marked food drive. So we are raising, not raising money, we're raising food. How does that work? Anybody growing the food that you're going to donate? No. So it'd be great if you were, but we're looking for non-perishable items that we can donate to the food cupboards to keep them stocked this winter. So if you are going shopping or you're going through your pantry and you've got things that you want to donate, I would ask that you just check and make sure nothing is expired, because we can't give that to them. They can't give it away. If you're thinking about those that have less, please just pick up an extra box of macaroni and cheese or something to bless a family, and drop it off, and we'll be distributing that to the different food banks in the area. There's two or three of them, and we wanna support those ministries, and we would love your help with that. So we were supposed to put a roof on for a gentleman yesterday, but because I was so sick, I was like, let's not do this on Wednesday. Probably could have done it yesterday. But anyway, so we pushed that till next week. We're going to do that next Saturday. So once again, this is a project for a gentleman that goes to our Monday night Bible study, not regularly, but occasionally. He knows kind of the Lord and is working out his life. He's got some mixed ideas, but we thought there was no better way that we could show him the love of God and the love of family than to meet this person in their need. And so if you want to help me throw a roof on a trailer next Saturday, we're going to meet here at the church at 8 o'clock, unless it's raining, in which case it'll be the following Saturday. But I do want to try to get this done before snow gets too crazy. Amen? All right. Fellowship dinner is next Sunday after church. And so there is a sign-up sheet that will continue to go around. There's a lot on here already, but please feel free to grab this. Actually, Micah, make sure this goes around during our offering time, okay? And then lastly, Mission Sunday is November 19th, and we will be having guest speaker Rachel Mullins here, who is our missionary to Honduras, and she'll be sharing about the ministry that she's doing with kids in Honduras. That's fantastic. And so I hope you guys will come and be ready to give a good offering. This morning, we're going to take up a special offering for Unity Christian School as we are doing our tithes and offerings. So we like to bless the school that ministers to kids and helps educate young people for the Lord. It's an alternative education to the public school system. And I want to just encourage you guys to give generously as we do this. So we're going to switch gears and take up our tithes and offerings. So if the gentlemen want to come and you want to stand again, I just want to get you a little bit of exercise. Right? That way you don't fall asleep. Amanda, you're one of the teachers at Unity Christian School. Would you come here and would you pray over the offering? I hate to put you on the spot, but you know I love to.
Oh, I know you love to. All right. Thank you, God, for being with us today. God, I thank you that we can gather freely. We can worship you, God, and we can focus on you. Just give you our hearts for this time. And God, I just ask your blessing over the church's finances. God, I ask you to bless your people so that we can give freely, not worrying about, you know, tomorrow and how you're going to provide. God, help us to trust in you as we're faithful to obey your word that says to tithe. God, we give back to you. God, we give back to you what you've provided. And God, we pray your blessing over Unity Christian School. God, we pray your blessing over the teachers, over the students, God, the work, the ministry. Everything that people put their hands to, God, we pray your blessing over that school. God, I pray for your provision over that school. You know what you want to see happen, God, and help us to be generous to give, God, and I just pray your blessing over that. We love you, Father. I thank you that we can be here together today. God, thank you for bringing us here. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. So come, bring your tithes and offerings. Greet one another in the Lord. There's some new people here. Make sure you shake a hand and get to know somebody. I'm going to give you 2 minutes, guys. Lately, it's been hard to reel you in, so let's go. Okay, guys, we're going to bring it back in. I want to make sure we have plenty of time to spend in God's presence and to hear the word today. So we're going to refocus our energy and our hearts. Hopefully I didn't give Jake what I had. So I'm going to turn it over to our brother Jake. You know what? I really appreciate Jake. Jake does a lot for this church. He does a lot for the community. And I just love my brother. And I hope you enjoy the fact that he's bringing a sacrifice of praise this morning. I know he's not feeling super fantastic. So I totally understand what that's like.
All right. Good morning. So I'm going to apologize for my voice up front. So last night, long story short, I had a dream that someone was breaking into the window behind my bed, and I woke up screaming at the top of my lungs for 10 to 20 seconds, which I'm sure was, you know, comforting to my wife that, you know, that's what I would do in that situation. I didn't try to protect her, didn't try to jump over. No, I just stood up on my bed, and I just screamed at the top of my lungs. So that's that. So my voice is a little bit shot this morning. It's feeling a little bit raw. So luckily I have these lovely ladies here that are going to mostly lead the songs this morning. but I do want to share a scripture and one other thing before we begin this morning. So I'm going to be reading out of Psalm chapter 34, verse 1 through 9. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise will always be on my lips. I will boast in the Lord. The humble will hear and be glad. Proclaim the Lord's greatness with me. Let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord, and he answered me and rescued me from all of my fears. Those who look to him are radiant with joy. Their faces will never be ashamed. This poor man cried, and the Lord heard him and saved him from all of his troubles. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him, and he rescues them. Taste and see that the Lord is good. How happy is the person who takes refuge in him. You who are his holy ones, fear the Lord, for those who fear him lack nothing. All right, so this morning as a corporate body, my hope is that we would join together. We would position ourselves in our minds so that he is the only thing that we see, and that we would bless the Lord with our words. So no matter what happened before you got here or earlier this week, whether you went through a valley or you stood up on top of a mountain peak, we are called to bless the Lord in all things. So yes, we may have gone through valleys before arriving here this morning, but the word says that when we bless the Lord and praise him, it helps bring back to our memory the good things that he has done in the past and how countless times he's raised us up out of the pits that we often find ourselves in. So once again, my hope this morning is that we can come together and bless the Lord with our words and our posture in worship this morning. And that when you do that, you find or refind the peace and the goodness of God.
We thank you, God, our creator, the lover of our souls, the one who knows us down to our toes, the deepness of us, God. And God, you still choose us. You choose us. You made us to worship you. That is our highest calling. Every other calling is second to a worshiper and a praiser of our God. And we just thank you this morning. We just love you. We adore you. Father God, help us on the inside to surrender all thoughts, everything about us, Lord, so that we might come into your presence this morning and hear you and sense you and know you. Not what you can do for us, but to know the very God who has made us and is longing and longing for us to draw near. We desire to draw near, God. We choose to draw near to you today, Lord. We just thank you. We thank you, Holy Spirit, that you dwell and you stir within us. Holy Spirit, stir. Stir in us, God. Just stir within us. Hallelujah, that you might be glorified today. We just praise you. Receive our worship. Receive it unto you, God, as incense, sweetness before you.
Jesus, I surrender all to him. I freely give. I will ever love and trust him in his presence.
same God who's never lame is working all things out. He's working all things out. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh, yes, I will. I choose to praise, to glorify, glorify the name of all names. Oh, that nothing can stand against. I choose to praise, to glorify, glorify the name of all names. And nothing can stand against. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Yes, I will for all my days. Yes, I will, oh, for all my days. Yes, I will. I choose to praise, to glorify, glorify the name of all names. Oh, that nothing can stand against. I choose to praise, to glorify, glorify the name of all names. Oh, that nothing can stand against. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh, yes, I will for all my days. Oh, yes, I will for all my days. Yes, I good and the bad. We praise you, Father. No matter what I'm going through, I will choose to praise. Oh, yes, to praise you, God. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. You are good in all your ways. You are good in all your ways. Yes, Lord, you are good in all your ways. You are good in all your ways. Oh, you are good, Father. You are good in all your ways. Yes, to praise, to glorify, glorify the name of all names. Oh, that nothing can stand against. I choose to praise, to glorify, glorify the name. name of all names. Oh, that nothing can stand against. Oh, yes, Lord. Oh, Lord. We have no reason to fear, for you conquered it all, Lord. We have no reason to fear. You conquered the grave, you conquered my sin, Lord, yes. We thank you for your goodness, Father. Thank you for your goodness, Father. Mercies every day. Thank you for your goodness, God. Yes, Lord. Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place, though I walk. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name, blessed be the name. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name when the sun's shining down on me, when the world's all that it should be. Blessed be your name. Blessed. Blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glory. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Oh, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Oh, yes, Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Oh, blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your glorious name. Yes, Lord, bless me, Father. Yes. Stand or fall on. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. You're my one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. You're my one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All of my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the good. Darkest night, you are close like no other. Oh, I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend. I have lived in the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. So good, every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running. It's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. Every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my
Surrender.
Jesus, breathe within. Lord, have your way. Lord, have your way in me. Like a mighty storm, stir within my soul. Lord, have your way. Lord, your way in me. Oh Lord, have your way. Lord, have your way in me. Oh Lord, have your way. Lord, have your way in me. Oh Lord, to know you more. I surrender. I surrender. I want to know you more. I want to know you
Holy Spirit. Lord, we just honor your presence in this place. Father, we surrender our hearts to you and our lives. And Father God, we even come to that place where we say, examine us, O Lord. Create in us a clean heart, O God. Renew a right spirit within us. Father, wash us and cleanse us. Transform us today. God, we just humble ourselves in your presence, Lord. We give you glory and honor and praise. You are the King. We stand in the presence of the King, church. Bless the Lord. Amen. What a joyous and humbling time in God's presence this morning. I think kids are heading downstairs. If they aren't, they should be. So we're going to release you. And, you know, we have the blessing of having one of the most amazing guys that I have ever had the privilege of serving under. He was our district superintendent for, 20 years, and is now currently our superintendent emeritus. Which means basically he was so good at the job or so blessed in the job that they decided he's never allowed to retire. So they have somebody else that does the daily stuff, but he's always going to be our superintendent in some way, shape, Reform. We just are honored to have Pastor or Dennis Marquardt with us today. We're just going to give you your liberty, and thank you so much for being here.
Now that I'm not superintendent, I get to say things I couldn't say before. And Pastor Tony and Amanda are two of our favorite people. We just love them, and I can still remember sitting around, I don't know if you remember this, in Farmington? Remember sitting around, you were a board member. You had just come on the board, and I remember thinking God has his hand on this man's life. And so it's been a joy to watch his journey, and he and Amanda and what God has done. And when the church was open here, I knew he'd be a perfect candidate for this church. And you saw fit to see that too. And we are just delighted that they're here, that you're here. And this is the day the Lord has made, and we will and be glad in it, right? So there's a lot of stuff going on in the world, but I came this morning to proclaim some really good news during bad times, all right? Because that's the job of the preacher, is good news. So we're going to look at a passage of Scripture. First, I'm going to tell you ahead of time, this verse I'm going to read is highly controversial. And when it was written and delivered to the audience that it was delivered to, they gasped. They literally gasped when the Apostle Paul or Barnabas, whoever wrote the book of Hebrews, wrote this verse. There was actually probably literally a gasp. You know, sometimes when we read the Bible, we read the words from our perspective of being Americans in an American culture. But when these verses were written, they were written to real people at real times with really different understanding and views than what we had. And so what is going to look like, when I put the verse up here, you're going to go, "There's nothing controversial about that." Well, I'll explain in a minute why it was highly controversial. Go ahead and put the verse up there first. This is Hebrews 4:16. This is the single text that we're going to land on today. "Let us then approach the throne of grace with confidence," or with boldness if you have a King James version, "so that we might receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need." You say, that doesn't sound very controversial. This was written to a group of people called Hebrews. That's why the book has that name. Do you know who these people were? These were Jews in Jesus' day that were still Hebraic Jews. These were Jews steeped in the Old Covenant and the Old Testament. And even though they had heard of Jesus and embraced Jesus as the Jewish Messiah that died for sins, they were still thinking like Jews. And in a Jewish mindset, you never came into God's presence boldly. You came into God's presence very carefully, right? So when the writer, we don't know who the author of the book of Hebrews was. The language is similar to some of the things that Paul says, but a little different. That some people think it was Barnabas that wrote the book because he had Paul's influence. Whoever wrote this to this book of this group of Hebrews, that when they saw this verse, they literally gasped. You don't come into the presence of God boldly. You come in carefully and fearfully, because we're going to go back and look at the Old Covenant in just a second, and you're going to see that. You know, this whole world is so scared of God, and people deny him. They're afraid of him. We who know the truth know that that's different when we come into a relationship with God. Let me tell you a story. This is actually a true story. There was a woman driving home from work one day, and she was a nice-looking gal, and she was single, and she had a nice car, and she pulled up to a red light and stopped, and in the lane next to her was one of these big rig truck drivers. And you know, their cabs sit up really high. And so she noticed she was waiting for the light to turn. He was there, and he kept staring at her. And how many of you women know you can feel uncomfortable sometimes with... And the and she thought, is this light never going to change? He just kept staring at her, and then he starts making some motions. So she's getting freaked out every second. She turns away from him. She doesn't want to look at him, but every time she peers in the corner of her eye, he's still staring at her and trying to get her attention. And finally, the light turns green, and you know what she did? She hit the gas. To her amazement, this truck driver hit the gas on his truck. It must have been empty. And he starts following her right on her bumper. I mean, literally just tailing her. So she starts driving faster and faster, hoping a cop will stop her for speeding. And you know, the cops are never there when you actually need to speed. And the faster she went, the faster he went. And he literally stayed on her bumper. And now she's getting more and more freaked out about this guy who is chasing her. And so finally she thinks, what am I going to do? How do I get rid of this guy? And she knew there was an exit coming up off the interstate. She thought, I'm just going to take that exit. That's not my home, but I'm going to take it. And I'm going to get off the exit. And the first gas station I see, I'm going to pull into the gas station, run into the into the inside area of the gas station, and use the phone and call the police. Evidently, this was prior to the days of a cell phone. She didn't have a cell phone. And so she pulled off the exit. And out of curiosity, watched in a rearview mirror, and guess who pulled off the exit with her? This truck driver. Again, just staying on her bumper. So now she's really scared. She starts swerving down some streets looking for a gas station. Everywhere she went, he went. Finally, she sees a station up ahead of the road. She comes flying into that gas station, puts the car in a park and leaves it running, and just jumps out of the car and runs into the inside and tells the guy inside the booth there, he says, I need to use your phone and call the police. To her utter amazement, the truck driver pulls into the gas station too, right alongside of her car, and she watches him jump out of the car and run over to her car, not toward her. And she watched him open the back door of her car and pull a guy in there that had been hiding, was planning on raping her and killing her, and pulled him out. The guy she was running from was not a dangerous man, he was actually her savior. And that's what this world is doing. They think of God as somebody that's going to take away everything from them. They think of God as chasing them down, and all he wants is control of their lives, when in reality, God is chasing us because he wants to save us. He wants to love us. In Old Testament times, God's people, the Jewish people, had a tough time having a personal relationship with God. Remember the story when Moses comes out of Egypt with the people of Israel? And they get in the desert, and Moses said, I won't go unless you go with us. So he said, I want your presence with us, God. So God gave him commands to build this tabernacle. And in this tabernacle, I think, let's see what I got. I think I had some other verses up here. Go to the next slide, if you would. This is still part of Hebrews, but it's a different chapter, because he's going to explain to these Hebrews what they already knew as Jewish Hebrews, which is that the first covenant was difficult to come into the presence of God in the Old Testament. The Jews in the wilderness journey did not understand coming into God's presence very safely. Moses built his tabernacle, which I'm going to show you in a minute, and the tabernacle had basically two rooms to it, then an outer court. And the presence of God was over the mercy seat of the Ark of the Covenant. And only one Jew, once a year, the high priest, got to go in there into the actual presence of God, just once a year. And when he went in, he had to make sure there was no sin in his life. Because you know what happened if he came into the actual presence of God with sin in his heart? He would die instantly. Now, the Jews have some other books besides the Bible, the Old Covenant, the Testament that we have, and one of their books is called the Talmud. In the Talmud, it actually describes a couple times when a couple high priests went in there with sin in their heart, and they died. Now, the problem was nobody else could go into the actual presence of God, or they would die too, so they had a dilemma. They said, how are we going to get a high priest out of there if he dies in the Holy of Holies when we can't go in there? So they put bells around the robe, the bottom robe of the high priest, so that they could hear the jingles, and they knew as long as they heard jingles, he was still alive in there. And then they thought, well, that's not going to be enough. So they came up with this plan to tie a rope or a sash around his ankle or his waist. And if all of a sudden the tingling stopped and they heard a thud, nobody had to go in there. They just pulled the rope and pulled his body out. Because once in a couple times, the Jewish Talmud says that happened. So what do you think the average Jewish mindset was about going into the actual presence of God? It wasn't come boldly, it was called come carefully. In fact, come fearfully. Or not at all, that's right, unless you're the high priest, not at all. And if you are the high priest, boy, I'll bet you he prayed up a storm the night before he went in. And in Hebrews, here the writer is going to reference all of that in the Old Covenant. He says, above the ark were the cherubim of the glory overshadowing the atonement cover, but we cannot discuss these things in detail now. When everything had been arranged like this, the priest entered regularly into the outer room to carry on their ministry. That was the Levites. They went into the holy place, but not the Holy of Holies. But only the high priest entered the inner room, and that only once a year, and never without blood, which he offered for himself and the sins the people had committed in ignorance. The Holy Spirit was showing by this that the way into the most holy place had not yet been disclosed as long as the first tabernacle was still standing. I think there's more. Right, another slide? Well, that's it. That was the single one? Okay. So he's kind of reminding them of what they already know, that only once a year and only this high priest ever got to go into the actual presence of God. Nobody else got to do that. Now he's building a case here because he wants to get to that passage that I read at the beginning where he's saying now with Jesus here, we don't have to fear coming into his presence. We can actually come boldly or with confidence. So we're going to get there in a second. Go to the next slide. I think this is the tabernacle, right? Yep. This is what that tabernacle looked like. This was the command that God gave to Moses to build. And this was true throughout the entire Old Testament. Later, Solomon builds his temple. In fact, that's actually the picture of Solomon's temple. But it was the same design and the same measurements and the same layout. So I've just used it up here for the tabernacle or the temple. But Solomon builds a permanent structure later on for the people of Israel. And you can see the Holy of Holies, actually, I got it stretched a little bit, but the Holy of Holies was a perfect square. It was the same dimensions on all four sides. The holy place, which says nave up there, was the place where the Levites took turns pastoring the people, and so if it was your assignment that week, you went into the holy place and made offered prayers and incense and stuff for the people, and you ministered to the people that were outside the tabernacle or the temple. The porch was just an area where people could gather, and I'm going to show you a little bit later on the areas where certain people were allowed to be. But that Holy of Holies had the Ark of the Covenant. Remember what was in the Ark of the Covenant? There were three things. Anybody remember? Aaron's rod that had budded, which was proof of him being the high priest. God had called him to be the high priest and nobody else. What else was in there? There was a jar of manna, which never spoiled, always stayed fresh. And the other third object was actually two things. The two tablets of the commandments of God, the word of God. All three of those were prophetic of the Messiah who one day would come, who would be in the Holy of Holies. But that was the whole, and on top of the Ark of the Covenant, and this, by the way, was made of acacia wood, and it was overlaid with gold. The mercy seat itself was solid gold. Now, I was over in Israel years ago, and I got to see some acacia wood. It's very dense, heavy, dark wood. And when you overlay it with gold, guess what? Guess how much more it weighs. So this Ark of the Covenant was huge. I mean, they had to put two poles in it, and probably 8 to 12 Levites had to carry this thing on their shoulders. This thing was really heavy, and the whole mercy seat, the lid, was solid gold. Now, you can imagine how much that weighed. And once a year, the high priest would go in there on the Day of Atonement or Yom Kippur. He would walk in there with blood to offer a blood sacrifice for all the sins of God's people that had taken place over the entire year. And he would go in there with the blood sacrifice. If his heart was clean, then he was allowed to live in the presence of God. And he could probably actually see the Shekinah glory, the actual presence of God, not in perfect form, but at least in shadow. And then he would sprinkle the blood on the mercy seat, And that would be God's way of accepting forgiveness of their sins. This was also prophetic of the day when Jesus, the Messiah, who would become our great high priest, would go from when he was crucified on Calvary into the Holy of Holies, into heaven, and present his own blood and sprinkle it on the mercy seat for us. So we're going to get there. Let's go to the next slide. Our forefathers had the tabernacle of the testimony with them in the desert. It had been made as God directed Moses, according to the pattern he had seen. Having received the tabernacle, our fathers under Joshua brought it with them when they took the land from the nations God drove out before them. It remained in the land until the time of David, and it was David's son Solomon that built a more permanent structure. Then they enjoyed God's favor and asked that he might provide a dwelling place for the God of Jacob, but it was Solomon who built the house for him. However, and this is out of the book of Acts, however, the Most High does not live in houses made by men. As the prophet says, heaven is my throne, earth is my footstool. What kind of house will you build for me, says the Lord? Or where will my resting place be? Has not my hand made all these things? This was just a temporary provision so that they could know the presence of God was among them, because there was nothing more important than knowing God was with you. And time, one of the most commonly written phrases in the Old Testament is, God went with them. God was with them, that God might be with me. I mean, that was the request for Moses. That was the request of Joshua. When Joshua took over, he said, I need to know that you are with me. They needed to know that God's presence was with them, but it was a fearful thing. Remember when Moses went up the mountain and there was thunder and lightning, and God told Moses, tell the people of Israel to gather at the base of the mountain. I'm going to come down and talk to them. Remember that story? It says that the thunder and lightning was so great, Moses comes down from the mountain. I think Joshua might have been with him. And when he got near the base of the mountain, the people of Israel said, you know what? I don't think we want to listen to him. You talk to him and just tell us what he says. And they backed away. They moved away. Because they were afraid. They were afraid of God's presence. A lot of people are that way today still. They're afraid of God's presence. That's the way most of the people in the world are today. They're afraid of God's presence. They're like that girl who was running from what was her savior, not her tormentor. So in Acts here, Luke is actually kind of referencing all this, saying, look, our forefathers went through this phase where there was this tabernacle. To be in God's presence was a difficult process. Go to the next slide. This is the more permanent structure, and this shows you kind of the areas. If you were a woman, number nine, if you look at number nine there, that was the court of the women. If you were a Jewish woman, that's the closest you could get to the presence of God under the old covenant. You had that outer porch area, that number nine there, which was the court of the women. Then if you wanted, then number seven was the altar of sacrifice. The court of Israel was number six. This is where the average Jewish man could go, was in area number six, which was kind of all around the tabernacle. But they were just the regular Jewish men, and that's the closest they could get. They weren't a whole lot closer than the women. But then when you get to number five, you get to the court of priests, and then in number three, you get to the holy place, which is the inside, the first room that you would come into. And here the priests would go in, and they would offer up prayers and incense, the prayers of the people, and they would intercede for the people, and they would minister to the people outside. And this is where they did their pastoral ministry, was from that location. And because that room was kind of not massive, and there were a lot of Levites, they had to take turns. They were assigned certain weeks that they would be in there. Actually, when Jesus is born, there's a reference to the priests that were on duty in that particular time frame. And then, of course, number two is this massive curtain. And I say massive, I mean it was massive. It was, I forget how many layers thick it was, but it was more like a wall. And you talk about heavy. It had gold threads woven through it. It had all kinds of different materials. It was a massive pole. Just to push that curtain aside took some work. And the reason it was so heavy and it was so thick is because God didn't want anybody to break through that curtain unless it was the high priest on the day of Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, because he didn't want to accidentally slay somebody by them coming into his presence when they weren't supposed to. So the curtain was massive in size. And that was what number two was. And then number one was the Holy of Holies. Like I said, that's supposed to be a perfect square there. It's not on the diagram, but it is. And in that room was that, the only thing in that room was the Ark of the Covenant. And that's where that the high priest once a year would go in there, and then he would get to enjoy being in the actual presence of God. I want to talk to those guys when I get to heaven, because it must have been something to be inside that room with the Shekinah glory above the mercy seat of God and those cherubim. Some people think there was almost lightning bolts going back and forth between them because they faced each other. I don't know, but it must have been an awesome, awesome thing to be in God's presence. You know, it still is an awesome thing to be in God's presence, isn't it? All right, so that was kind of the layout. So you can see, if you wanted to go into the actual presence of God, it was a process. And depending on who you were, depending on how far you could get. This was never God's plan for the rest of humanity. This was just a early stage of making his presence available before there was a perfect sacrifice for sins made. So he had to create a barrier so we weren't destroyed by coming into the presence of a holy God, because sin can't exist in the presence of a holy God. So that was a dilemma. So that's why God, in the fullness of time, sent forth his Son. Because God knew this couldn't be the permanent structure for having a relationship with him. So he needed to send somebody. But these were the shadows of what was to come. Let's go to that next passage of scripture. There's an interesting description of something that happens when Jesus is nailed on the cross and he's dying on the cross that is highly significant and often not preached about a lot. So I'm going to throw it in here for us. In Matthew 27, it says, when Jesus had cried out again in a loud voice, he was on the cross. Now he'd been on there for a long time. He was about ready. He cried out with a loud voice. He gave up his spirit. At the moment, the curtain of the temple was what? Torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook and the rocks split. The tombs broke open and the bodies of many holy people who had died were raised to life. This massive curtain, when Jesus was hanging out there on Calvary, and as he gives up the ghost and he dies, that major, I don't know who was on duty that day, because there was some high priest in there. But what a shock he was in for when he hears this tearing sound, this ripping sound of this massive, which nobody could do in the natural. This was not the result of just the earthquake tearing it, because it tore in a unique way that an earthquake wouldn't have caused. And it ripped right behind him in half. It just tore right in half. I don't know what Levites were in the holy room, but I'm sure they just went, whew. They'd probably turned away because they didn't want to see, because it meant instant death for them. At least that's what they would have thought. The high priest, if he was in there, must have just about went crazy. All of a sudden, it's open. It's wide open. But this was God's plan. And God... it's just interesting that Jesus at that moment, though he gave up his spirit, he goes to the Holy of Holies in heaven, and as our high priest, he offered his own blood up, and it was acceptable before Almighty God, only this time it was once and for all. No more daily, no more annual, no more Yom Kippur was necessary, no more Day of Atonement, no more earthly high priest. Jesus finished it all, and so the curtain was unnecessary anymore. And this was God trying to make a statement to the Jews, because it was all Jews that were in the temple at that time. And what God was trying to say to the Jews is, my Son that you just crucified on Calvary's hill, the way is wide open now, and I've torn the temple. I think the next picture has a picture of what the curtain looked like, right? Go back to the first one. You can, I mean, try to visualize how there must have been 12 layers to this thing or more. I don't know how many, I forget how many layers there were. But there's layer upon layer upon layer upon layer. Some of the gold threads, actually, it was real gold that they wove into some of the material. So you can see how big and heavy this thing was. And then the next one is the picture of it being rent in two from top to bottom. By the way, if it had been an earthquake, it would have ripped from the bottom up. So the scriptures say that it ripped from the top down, meant that God from the heavens was tearing it. So that's a highly significant little detail. And this must have been, you can see the guy is shocked there. I mean, he's going, oh no, it's wide open now. But that's what God was trying to say. He wanted the Jewish people. These were the seed of Abraham. By the way, there's a lot going on in the Middle East right now. And I don't know if you're aware of this, but the prophetic time clock started in 1948. On March 14th, 1948, Israel became a nation. They had not existed as a nation until 70 AD. So for almost 2,000 years, there was no nation of Israel. God said in the last days, my people, the Israelites, will be in their land. On March 14th, 1948, they were declared their own nation. And 11 minutes in, the first nation to recognize Israel as a nation, only took 11 minutes, was the President of the United States of America. We were the first country that acknowledged that nation. You want to hear something really freaky? Jerusalem would be declared as its capital. Jerusalem has not been the capital of Israel until our last president declared Jerusalem the capital of the Jewish state. You know when he did that? And I don't even know if he knows this. He did it on March 14th. The same date, the exact date that they became a nation, 70 years to the year. 70 is a significant number in the Bible, prophetically. And I don't know if our former president was aware that he did it on March 14th, 70 years to the year, that they were declared a nation, but I think that was a little prophetic fulfillment that was taking place. And what God is doing with Israel is going to be interesting, because we could be hearing the sound of the trumpet any day. So be ready. So the way is wide open. The veil is torn. The entranceway to God has been made completely wide open. Jesus came. The world just doesn't understand Jesus coming. I'll give you a little story again. There was a guy named Lloyd Preston, I think his name was. He was a police officer in Utah, Salt Lake City, Utah. He had been a police officer for a number of years, so they asked him to teach the rookies. So he went down to the city hall and used the library to teach a class to a bunch of rookies who were going to be police officers. And I forget what year this was. It was a few years ago. He was down there and he was teaching this class. He was in plain clothes, but he did have his revolver with him. He always carried that. And the class was over, and he had dismissed the students. They had all left. He was cleaning up the classroom. As he stepped out into the hallway, he stepped out into the hallway at the moment that a violent man with a gun had just herded 19 hostages up. And the man was screaming at these 19 hostages and said to them, I'm going to kill each and every one of you. Get in the side room. I'm not going to bargain with the police. I'm just going to execute you one at a time. So he pushed them all into the side room. So this police officer thought, I can't take him on alone. I'd start shooting. There's innocent people here. What can I do? The only thought that came to him is he had hoped that this hostage taker had not done an actual count of the number of people, those 19 people. So he was in plain clothes. You know what he did? He just slipped in with the hostages and became one of them. So now 20 of them were herded into the side room. The police tried to get the guy on the phone and tried to bargain with him to let a hostage go. And he said, I'm not letting anybody go. I'm going to start executing them, and I'm starting right now. And he called the first guy up in line, and it was this Lloyd Preston. Lloyd walked up to the hostage taker, who didn't know he was a police officer. He simply pulled his revolver out and shot and killed the hostage taker. And the incident was over. This man saved the lives of 19 other people because the hostage taker didn't recognize that he had slipped in and become one of them. This is what Jesus did 2,000 years ago. He came from heaven and slipped in among us as humans. He looked human. He was human. He was 100% human, while at the same time he was 100% God. He wasn't 50-50. He was 100-100. And he slipped in, and he looked like a common person. That's why the Jewish nation had such a hard time receiving him. They said, isn't this Joseph Carpenter's son? I mean, he's just a man. And Satan thought, I can even have them crucify and kill him. But all of that was all part of God's greater plan for Jesus to become the one who slipped in among the hostages, us, And at the moment when Satan was going to finally throw his last hand down and kill the Son of God, Jesus rose from the dead and saved us all and took care of that old devil. You know, he doesn't really have any power. He's already been done in by the Son of God. So the veil was torn, the way was wide open. Let's go to the next slide. And now we getting kind of back to where I started. Therefore, since we have a great high priest who has gone through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we profess, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way just as we are, yet without sin. And then the great verse that startled these Jewish Hebrews. So now let us approach the throne of grace with confidence or with boldness, so that we might receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. This was unheard of to them. You mean we can actually just right now come into the very presence of God boldly and with confidence? You're not perfect, but God is, and Jesus is, and he died for your sins and he's forgiven them. So how do we be perfect even as our Heavenly Father is perfect? We are perfect through Jesus Christ. That's the only way you can be perfect. You're not going to be perfect the way you are personally. You're going to be perfect in him. But because Jesus is in your heart and you've received him as your Savior, you get to come into the actual presence. You get to do something that Moses would have never dreamed of, or Joshua would have hoped for, or the Hebrews in the Old Testament would have loved to live in our day, when they could actually come into the actual presence of God, because they didn't get the privilege to do it like we get to do it. So what's the good news today? We get to approach the throne of grace with confidence. In just a minute, we're going to have some prayer, and I hope some of you are going to approach the throne of God with confidence. We're going to pray for you, whether it's healing or some other need. We're going to take a few moments, but first I'm going to have Bevy Jo come. She's going to sign to a song that encapsulates this entire sermon. So Bevy Jo, if you will come at this time.
In the Holy of Holies, behind the heavy veil, sat the Ark of the Covenant, where the Most High would dwell. And only the High Priest could enter therein to offer up a sacrifice for atonement of sin. But the veil was rent in an instant, revealing that holy place. For on a hill nearby, on a rugged cross, justice met.
My petitions, Lord.
So, Pastor, I'll probably need your help and maybe a couple of the board members that help. But we're going to take a moment before we dismiss officially. We're going to ask if any of you want to come boldly into the throne of grace, and we're going to pray for you. If you need healing, we'll pray for healing. If you need a touch in your some other reason, we'll pray for you for that. But I want you to know, God laid this message on my heart because he wants his people to know we can come. He wants you to come. He went through all this history in the past to create an open door for you to come into the actual presence of God. I am so glad we live in the New Testament times when we have this free access. And Jesus's sacrifice was so powerful. Did you see what happened on there? It says when he died, it says bodies of the dead were opened in Jerusalem, and many of the holy people were seen walking around. Jesus's power is so great. Every funeral he went, there are about five places in the New Testament that says he went to a funeral. Every funeral he went to, they rose from the dead. Because you can't be into the presence of Jesus without power emanating from him. So now you get to come boldly and with confidence. So if you want prayer, just come. The rest of you can just pray quietly in your seats there for a few minutes. We'll do a dismissal prayer in a moment. But we want to pray for some people. It would be wrong to preach a message like this and not do that. So just pray quietly in your place if you're not going to be one that comes. And let's pray for some.